Let me introduce our first speaker. Governor Mark Dayton began his career, not his political career, but his professional career as somebody committed to social justice. He began teaching in inner city New York public schools, and his career throughout has been one, whether as a teacher, as the state auditor, as a U.S. senator, and now as governor, dedicated to social justice. That's what Senator Humphrey and Vice President Humphrey was all about. And today, as we call upon Governor Dayton, we do so because with this dedication, this memorial now becomes the property, a part of the state of Minnesota. Governor Dayton, we're delighted to be able to present this to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Senator Cohen. And it's my honor to accept this wonderful memorial on behalf of the people of the state of Minnesota. About the second week I was in the United States Senate in January of 2001, I was invited to the retirement reception for a woman who had worked on the staff of Senator Humphrey after he returned from being vice president. And she was at the time then working for Georgia Senator Max Cleland. So as we're standing in the hallway there, Senator Cleland's neighbor in the Senate came walking by. It was Senator Jesse Helms. And the woman introduced me to him. I had not yet met him. And said, Senator Dayton, the new senator from Minnesota, Senator, I used to work for Hubert Humphrey. And Senator Helms paused for a moment. He said, you know, when Hubert Humphrey came to the Senate, I didn't think I would like him. I mean, we didn't agree on anything, but he had the biggest heart. And then he paused, then he continued. He said, I remember the last time he came to the Senate floor. And at that point, he choked up, and the tears started streaming down his face. And I remembered something Vice President said, Senator Helms, Hubert Humphrey said, a man who can't cry is a man who has no heart. And he took my hand and shook it in appreciation. And that quote came from a speech, iconic speech that I saw played many times at AFL-CIO gatherings. Dave Rowe brought everybody to tears. The speech that the vice president gave reportedly the night after he learned that he had terminal cancer. And he said, a man who can't cry is a man who has no heart. He said, I'd rather live 50 years like a tiger than 100 years like a chicken. And he showed the passion, he showed the deep commitment, the love he had for the people he served, the love he had for the state of Minnesota, the love he had for this great country. And it was so obvious he cared. He didn't want to leave this life because he cared so much about what he was doing. He believed in what he was doing, and he knew he was making a difference. And it's that passion, it's that commitment, it's that dedication to making this world a better one before we pass on that I think is the living legacy of this great man and will be the living legacy of this memorial. Thank you.
Thank you, Governor Dayton. One of the hallmarks of Senator Humphrey and Vice President Humphrey was his work on a bipartisan basis. All of us who know the history of the 1964 Civil Rights Act know that that's how it was put together when he approached the then Minority Leader Everett Dirksen of Illinois. And representing that kind of bipartisanship and that kind of bipartisan ability to govern is Governor Arne Carlson. And Governor Carlson was also the governor who signed the first appropriation relative to this memorial. Governor Carlson.
Thank you very much, Senator Cohen and Mr. Vice President, distinguished members of the United States Senate, and beloved members of the Humphrey family and dear friends of Hubert Humphrey. As a young man working on the Humphrey presidential campaign staff, we always referred to him as the Senator. There was no other name, just the Senator, because he personified that title. Titles do not create leaders. Rather, leaders give definition to titles. And that is why Hubert H. Humphrey will always be the Senator. And he has left to us a legacy, and a challenge. Public service meant serving the public good. It was not about personal gain or poll numbers. No, he understood the great issues of the day, and he vigorously participated and led. In Mr. Smith Goes to Washington, actor Jimmy Stewart, fighting desperately for his cause, acknowledged that maybe it was a lost cause. But then he went on to declare that they're also the ones that are worth fighting for. When the senator fought for civil rights, it was a lost cause. But he clearly understood that this cause was worth fighting for. And ultimately, America agreed, and we all stand taller for it. Today, amidst a dysfunctional political system, a system where compromise is under attack and disagreement is all too often treated as disloyalty, the senator would likely summon his full passion and energy to advance his own core beliefs, beliefs of reason, goodwill, and opportunity for all. He saw America as it could be, and he brought out the best in all of us. Today, we dedicate a statue in his honor. But in a broader sense, we dedicate ourselves to his belief in public service and his courageous commitment to it. Senator, thank you very much. Thank you.
I mentioned last night that we had a remarkable evening with members of the Humphrey staff. John Stewart, one of the most significant individuals working for Senator and Vice President Humphrey, said that, as far as he was concerned, one of the personifications in today's contemporary United States Senate, from all of the senators, was our next speaker, and what a better introduction than what John Stewart gave her, our senior senator, Senator Amy Klobuchar.
Thank you, Senator Cohen. Very kind. Thank you, everyone. It's such an honor to be here. We're going to hear from President Clinton, but also with Vice President Mondale, Senator Franken, Senator Coleman, Senator Boswich, Representative McCollum and Luther, Governor Carlson, Governor Dayton, Attorney General Humphrey. This was a day like no other. For those of you visiting from out of town, let's just say not every summer day this year has been this nice. So Hubert Humphrey is smiling down on us today. I was in high school, 1978, a senior in high school, when Hubert Humphrey died. And like tens of thousands of Minnesotans, I stood out in that line with my dad in a winter coat and hat and mittens. It was probably 100 degrees colder than it is right now. But you think of those people, tens of thousands of people in line, and that's how much Minnesota loved Hubert Humphrey. To this day, neither Minnesota nor the United States Senate has ever seen anyone quite like him with his burst of energy and optimism. When you look at the landmark laws that have been passed during the last 60 years, Humphrey's fingerprints are on all of them. From civil rights to Medicare to nuclear arms control, the list goes on and on. But as his legacy, Hubert Humphrey left us even more than these great legislative achievements. What he gave us was a spirit of optimism, the hope and belief that working together, we can make tomorrow better than today. When people come and see this statue and this beautiful memorial, that's the single most important thing I hope that they remember. Because as we all know, optimism isn't always easy to hold on to. You think of back in 1948, a young mayor, his whole political career in front of him. What a gutsy move. He went to that convention and he took on civil rights. He was convinced that racial segregation and Jim Crow were an ugly stain on our democracy, and he was determined to challenge the status quo. He was optimistic that the good in America would trump prejudice. Now, not everyone was happy. As he spoke, 35 Dixiecrat delegates stood up and left. But Humphrey didn't let it faze him, and he didn't back down. In circumstances like that, it takes courage to stay optimistic. Okay, the president is here. I noticed everyone was looking away from my remarks. And so we welcome President Clinton.
Paul and Silas bound to jail. Had no money to get their bail.
Thank you so much, President Clinton. We are so excited to have you here today. And I will say that you share that Humphrey quality of optimism that I was just talking about. See the segue. And you not only had that optimism when you were president, but most importantly to all of us, you've continued that optimism when you've left the White House, and our country and our world are the better for it. So thank you for that. I will tell you, it is somewhat amusing for me to have this happen, because my favorite story, my first moment in Washington, was with President Clinton when I got to introduce him, when he introduced the hate crimes legislation as a young prosecutor. I stood outside of the East Room with him, nervous, and I was told to walk in at a certain time, and the band started playing Hail to the Chief. And I started walking, and all of a sudden I felt this big hand on my shoulder, and this voice said, "You're gonna do great out there, but when they play that song, I usually go first." All right, true story. Hey, that was my first thing in Washington, this was my second, so there. I was talking about the optimism of Hubert Humphrey. The last thing I would leave you with, as you come to see this statue and people all over the world see it, is just the belief that he had in the people that he represented. There's a longtime story told by Norman Sherman, who's out there, about when Humphrey asked him to write every year the letters congratulating the people who won prizes at our great Minnesota State Fair. Now, back then, 600 people won prizes, including honorable mentions. And these were things like butter sculptures, of course, blue ribbon honey, and seed art. In fact, President Clinton, you would be glad to know that your picture was forever fixed up on the wall in the crop art exhibit made in glued-on kernels of corn. Well, back when Humphrey was in the Senate, Norm Sherman went up to him and said, "You know, Mr. Senator, we have so much important work to do than write these 600 letters." And Humphrey said this to him. He said, "We recognize achievement. Maybe these people didn't win a Nobel or a Pulitzer, but a handicraft or an animal or a flower or a bottle of homegrown beans, it's what they do. And if they did it well enough to win a prize, then that's also enough to merit a letter from their senator." You see, Humphrey cared about everyone, regardless of their status. And that's why I have his picture in my lobby right when you walk in. And I put it there for a reason. It's a reminder that more than ever, our nation needs a good, strong dose of Humphrey optimism and a stronger dose of remembering the people that we were sent to represent. Today in Washington, we have a choice. We can hunker down in despair and defiance, pointing fingers of blame, or we can stand up and face these challenges directly with the confidence that if we work together, we can solve these problems. I have no question what Hubert Humphrey's choice would be. So in the days and months ahead, I hope people from all over the world come to see this statue. But most importantly, I hope people in Washington remember the spirit of Hubert Humphrey. I know I will. Thank you.
Mr. President, let me just thank you. You not only honor the memory of Senator Humphrey and Vice President Humphrey, but you honor the entire state of Minnesota by your presence today. Thank you very much for coming. Clearly one of the hallmarks of Senator and Vice President Humphrey's career was his passion for civil rights. And during the several years that our next speaker has served in the U.S. Senate, that has been his passion, his commitment, and his work. Senator Al Franken has worked tirelessly on behalf of women's rights, on behalf of GLBT rights, on the rights of all Minnesotans and all Americans. It's one of the things he has dedicated himself to, similarly as Vice President Humphrey and Senator Humphrey did as well. Our next speaker, our junior senator, Senator Al Franken.
Thank you, Dick, for those kind words. Thank you. It is a tremendous honor to be here today for this dedication and before all the distinguished guests who are here and speakers who are here. Mr. President, thank you for coming during Amy's speech. And Amy, good cover. You did a good job, good cover. Hubert Humphrey was known as the Happy Warrior. His service was guided by principle, but always in the spirit of generosity and goodwill. In the Senate, he got great things done because he got along with even his ideological opposites. Barry Goldwater, a good friend of Hubert Humphrey, said of him, "Hubert has been clocked at 275 words a minute with Gus up to 340. While Hubert Humphrey famously used a lot of words, the words that he spoke were so eloquent and so memorable. And I would emphasize that they are as meaningful and eloquent and urgent today as they were when he said them. Take two of the quotations that are etched in this memorial. "The time has arrived for the Democratic Party to get out of the shadow of states' rights and walk into the bright sunshine of human rights." That is as true today as it was in 1948. And you know that if Hubert Humphrey were with us today, he'd be leading the fight against the two constitutional amendments that are on this year's ballot. One which seeks to enshrine discrimination in our state constitution, and one which would disenfranchise many of the poor, the elderly, and minorities. And perhaps his most famous quote about those in the dawn of life, our children, those in the twilight of life, the elderly, and those who are in the shadows of life, the sick, the needy, and the handicapped. You know that if Hubert Humphrey were with us today, he would be fighting for full funding of Head Start. He would be fighting to keep Medicare a guarantee for our seniors. And for making sure that those who are hungry have access to food, and those who are poor and sick have access to health care. And he'd be fighting against cuts to food stamps and to Medicaid. Hubert Humphrey's words are alive. His spirit is alive. A memorial isn't just about looking back. It is about the debt we owe to those who came before us and the obligation we have to those who are here today and to future generations. I know that the happy warrior would believe that we can fulfill that obligation. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Franken. Our next speaker is one of Minnesota's civil rights pioneers, a very close friend of Senator Humphrey, a very great career as an educational consultant. Dr. Josie Johnson was also the first African-American member of the University of Minnesota's Board of Regents. But before we listen to Dr. Johnson, let's listen to just a few seconds of a young mayor of Minneapolis running for the United States Senate, speaking before the 1948 Democratic National Convention in Philadelphia, and being the first politician to address a national convention on behalf of civil rights for all citizens.
My friends, to those who say that we are rushing this issue of civil rights, I say to them, we are 172 years late. To those who say that this civil rights program is an infringement on states' rights, I say this: the time has arrived in America for the Democratic Party to get out of the shadows of states' rights and to walk forthrightly into the bright sunshine of human rights.
As I mentioned, one of Minnesota's civil rights pioneers, a close friend of Vice President Humphrey, please welcome Dr. Josie Johnson.
Thank you very much. My remarks are a call for courage. When Vice President Humphrey delivered his address to the 1948 Democratic National Convention on July 17, 1948. I was 17 years old and a sophomore at Fisk University in Nashville, Tennessee. In 1948, people could not vote. Black people could not vote in the South. My father and I spent days collecting petitions to do away with the poll tax in Texas. In 1948, school children went to segregated, inferior schools in the South. In 1948, lynching of black men, including soldiers, returning from World War II was an uncommon event, lynching. In 1948, Jim Crow laws were enforced. I share these few facts with you to illustrate the environment in which Vice President Hubert Humphrey delivered his address in the 1948 Democratic National Convention. It took courage to ask the convention to unlearn the teaching of the past. It took courage to ask his colleagues to rethink the teaching of superiority of one group over another. That was 1948. We are now in 2012, and we again need courage and courageous leaders like Vice President Humphrey. Leaders who can see the pending danger to our democracy. Leaders who can touch the hearts and minds of those who insist on living in the shadows of states' rights. Leaders who are principled and fair. Leaders who know the difference between truth and fiction. I ask, what did we learn from Hubert Humphrey about courage? I ask myself, how courageous am I 65 years after his address to the convention? I ask you, how courageous are you in 2012? We are living in such troubled times, and we need the courage of a Hubert H. Humphrey to continue the battle for our threatened democracy. In the memorial service in the U.S. Capitol Rotunda, Senator Edward Brooks of Massachusetts shared the last public words to his colleague. He said, "We must keep up the fight. If we do, I assure you, it will be well worth every effort we make." Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Johnson. Sometimes cliches have a lot of truth to them. So when I suggest what a great honor it is for me to introduce our next speaker, it's not a cliche. No one in Minnesota or American electoral history was closer to Senator and Vice President Humphrey than our next speaker. From the time he was a student at McAllister College, working on the 1948 Senate campaign, to assisting Senator Humphrey at the 1964 Democratic Convention in Atlantic City, to succeeding Senator Humphrey in the United States Senate, to serving with Senator Humphrey in the United States Senate, to working as Vice President with Senator Humphrey, and finally, delivering the eulogy at Senator and Vice President Humphrey's funeral, the words that we remember to this day: "He taught us how to live, and he taught us how to die." The single most respected person in the state of Minnesota, one of the single most respected people in the United States of America, the former Attorney General, the former United States Senator, the former Ambassador to Japan, the former Vice President of the United States of America, the Honorable Walter F. Mondale.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much, Senator Cohen, for those kind words. Mr. President, we are really grateful that you're with us today, and I'll add a few words to that before I sit down. It was one of my great fortunes in life to have lived alongside Hubert Humphrey for over 40 years, from his days as mayor of Minneapolis, where he broke the ice, to his days in the United States Senate as Vice President, candidate for President, and again back in the Senate. By that time, I was in the Senate, we were colleagues there, and at one point I was the senior senator and he was the junior senator. And I enjoyed calling him, "Mr. Junior Senator, we're so glad to have you here." I don't think he liked it. I
know and I knew Hubert, and I join with everyone here in rejoicing over this opportunity to remember him in this special way on behalf of the people of Minnesota and of our nation. Hubert was the single most influential and successful political leader in Minnesota history. He was also one of the most creative and successful public servants in our nation's history. At that memorial service that Senator Franken referred to, I quoted in referring to Hubert from words from Shakespeare that have always meant a lot to me. Shakespeare wrote, "A good leg will fail, a straight back will stoop, a black beard will turn white, a curled pate will grow bold, a fair face will wither, a full eye will wax hollow. But a good heart is like the sun and the moon, or rather the sun and not the moon, for it shines bright and keeps its course truly." That was our Hubert, and he changed our state, and he changed the nation. God bless him. Now, we are especially honored to invite to the platform the former President of the United States, William Clinton, an old and dear friend of Hubert's, a great champion of social justice and decency, a president who led America through its 8 best years of economic growth and stability, a profound period of social progress, a time of unity and respect in our country, and he gave us, our nation, the tone of unity and understanding that we so need. He is here today to honor his old friend, Hubert Humphrey. And the two of them remind each other, me of the two, each other. They both have endless energy. They both know how to give a speech. They are both full of hope and love and decency and optimism. And that's what we need right now. Mr. President, will you join us?
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Vice President, Governor Dayton, Governor Carlson, Senator Klobuchar, Senator Franken, Dr. Johnson, Senator Cohen, Skip Humphrey, my longtime friend and members of the Humphrey family, to all of you. First, thank you for giving me such a pretty day to come back to Minnesota and a crowd to stare at. I saw my friend Judge Alan Page and Diane out there. They used to jog with me when I was president, and I couldn't tell whether I was being protected or humiliated trying to keep up with them. I want to thank Fritz Mondale for many things, for being my friend for a long time, for being a fabulous ambassador to Japan. And I want to thank him for teaching me how to laugh in tough times. You may remember that 1980 was not such a hot year to be a Democrat. The Carter-Mondale ticket lost. I became the youngest former governor in American history. It was not a great year. And we had all these Cuban refugees that Castro had let loose, and they had all been deposited in my native state, where they proceeded to riot, much to my detriment and to Jimmy Carter's. In addition, we had the hottest summer in 50 years. And then, right before Vice President Mondale was scheduled to come to Arkansas to speak to the Democratic Convention to rescue us from all of our misery. A Titan missile silo exploded and a nuclear warhead popped off of the missile and landed in a cow pasture, giving my native state the only cow pasture on planet Earth with its very own nuclear warhead. So Fritz arrives in Arkansas, in the town where I grew up, to give this speech. And I said, you know, I was really grateful to you for sending me all those rioting refugees, and I didn't think I could be any more grateful until I... What is that? I once saw a state senator of mine get hit by the American flag. And he said, you know, I risked my life for that flag in World War II. I don't think I should be killed by it. Anyway, so Mondale arrives in the midst of all this tension. And I'm sitting there with him in a suite at the old Arlington Hotel. And he picks up the phone and calls the Secretary of Defense. We knew he was toast. We knew I was toast. We knew we were all marking time. And Fritz Mondale, in the midst of all that misery, said to Harold Brown, the Secretary of Defense, he said, Harold, I did ask you to get the people's minds off the Cuban refugee crisis, but I think this nuclear warhead was not what I had in mind. It said a lot about his character, as well as his sense of humor, and I never forgot it. I was a 26-year-old young man, first time I met Hubert Humphrey, and he was barging across a hotel lobby to go to his speech during the 1972 campaign. And I barged in through all the staff members and shook his hand. And I told him I was from Arkansas, and I thanked him for that 1948 speech. And I thanked him for helping to engineer the passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1964. And I thanked him for helping to change the course of America and to raise the level of common decency in the American South. All my life, I loved and admired Hubert Humphrey. He believed that public service was a noble endeavor. He believed that his adversaries need not be his enemies. He believed that with a happy heart and an open ear and an honest dialogue, a lot of conflicts could be resolved. And he lived his life to do it. When Al Franken said what Hubert Humphrey would be doing on some of these contentious political issues in Washington, I found no quarrel with it. But I think there's another set of issues which would concern him greatly. Hubert Humphrey believed that our founding fathers were serious when they pledged their lives, their fortunes, their sacred honor to form a more perfect union. He did not think it was an accident that our national motto was a pluribus unum. Nor did he think it was surprising that we had never become truly one out of many, since our founders legitimized slavery in the Constitution, even as Thomas Jefferson was saying that he trembled to think that God was just in the face of his and others' ownership of slaves. In other words, he believed that the lifetime work of every American was to do what was possible and at hand to form a more perfect union. And now, in spite of all the economic difficulties of the moment, in spite of this big increase in the debt that the current financial crisis has caused, as fewer people pay taxes and more people need unemployment and food stamps, last week, if you wanted to, you could borrow $1 million for a year for $15,000 in interest. In other words, less than inflation, because people still believe that we are on that mission to form a more perfect union. Therefore, I think it would disturb him when a member of the United States House of Representatives said that between 78 and 81 of his colleagues were members of the Communist Party. That actually happened a couple of weeks ago. And I thought to myself, I didn't think there were 80 communists left in the Western Hemisphere outside Cuba. So I thought it's kind of interesting. I wanted to know who the rascals were. And I'm still trying to find out. I think he would have been proud of John McCain for sticking up for the Secretary of State's aide, Huma Abedin, when she was attacked for being a Muslim. I think all these attempts to restrict the franchise by imposing new requirements on voting would bother him. You know, in Pennsylvania last week, they had litigation over the Pennsylvania restrictions, and it was a difficult time for those who were pushing them because the Attorney General of Pennsylvania stipulated that he could not produce one piece of evidence of voter fraud in Pennsylvania, and that if the court decided to strike down the voter requirements, he did not believe there would be an increase in voter fraud. And at the same time, the chief sponsor of the legislation said, he said, oh, I passed this bill to determine the outcome of the election in Pennsylvania. In Texas, where the lawsuit over their restrictions is being heard in Washington because of a past history of discrimination, when it was pointed out that poor Hispanic voters who live in rural areas and have low incomes would have to travel an average of 100 miles and spend $22 to become legally registered voters under these new requirements, the Attorney General said, heck, it's Texas. We're a big state. People, they get used to driving a long way. We're not talking about J.R. Ewing, folks. We're talking about minimum wage workers a long way from home for whom $22 is still a lot of money. What I want to say is, because of what Hubert Humphrey did, with all the problems we've got, we are well positioned for the 21st century economically for things that aren't directly related to economics. Your country is younger than Europe, younger than Japan, and in 20 years will be younger than China because Minnesota has grown more diverse. Because we have people from all over the world, from different religions and different races. And youth, having lost it, I can tell you this, youth matters to the economic future of a nation. It determines the range of possibilities. It doesn't guarantee us anything. We still have to be smart and innovate and invest in the right things. Do something about our long-term debt. We got to deal with all that. But what got us to the point of continuing possibility in the 21st century is the commitment to a more perfect union, to opening the doors of freedom and opportunity, to embracing our diversity instead of being afraid of it. And I always loved the Humphrey quote from late in his life that the moral test of government is how it treats those in the dawn of life, those in the twilight of life, those in the shadows of life. But that means that those things are necessary because we are trying to build a country of one out of many, because we are committed to a more perfect union, because we believe that a country of shared opportunities and shared responsibilities and a shared sense of community will produce greater prosperity and be a greater force for peace and security and decency and freedom all around the world. For as long as I live, I will be grateful for Hubert Humphrey's life. You have no idea how many times, I was only 2 years old when Hubert Humphrey gave that speech in 1948 that Dr. Johnson talked about. You have no idea how many times I watched a tape of that speech when I was a boy growing up in Arkansas, because I knew that that led directly to the passage of the Civil Rights Act, to the passage of the Voting Rights Act, to the passage of the Open Housing Act, and eventually to the election of Barack Obama as President of the United States. And I knew that it made possible for Keith Ellison to go to Congress. I knew that it made possible for people of all different kinds to stand up and be counted and be judged, in the words of Dr. King, not by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character and by their abilities and by their vision and by their ideas. I want to live in a country again where somebody in the Senate like Hubert Humphrey can sit down and cut a deal. That's supposed to be bad language. I think that's a noble thing. Can cut a deal with a man like Everett Dirksen and bring a civil rights bill to the floor that will pass with over 70 votes that are bipartisan, when actually, because of the lingering presence of Southern Democrats, a slightly higher percentage of Republicans than Democrats voted for it in the United States Senate. I want that kind of America again, where we can do things together across party lines because we believe we can build a more perfect union. And if it comes again, you remember what Senator Klobuchar said. It will not come from people who look like they spent all morning sucking lemons. It will not come from people who say the sky is falling. It will come from happy warriors. It will come from people who believe in the possibilities that lurk inside all of us. It will come from people that understand that every one of us, every single day, wakes up in the morning with a soul in the scales. And there's a few weights on the dark side and a few weights on the light side. And we have to decide every day of our lives whether the scales will tip light or dark, hope or fear, unity or division. Hubert Humphrey had a lot of things happen to him that could have weighed down the wrong side of those scales. He made a deliberate decision every day of his life to tilt the scales in the right direction, and so must we. Thank you very much.
Mr. President, again, thank you very much. You honor all of us by being here today. And now, on behalf of the family, the former Attorney General of the State of Minnesota, Hubert H. Humphrey III, Skip Humphrey.
Thank you very much, Senator Cohen. Mr. President, Mr. Vice President, governors, senators, all of those who are here who have served in public life and those who are just us taxpayers and voters, thank you so much for being here. What a wonderful day and wonderful celebration. The words that I have heard today bring back fond memories, bring back the sense of spirit that was part of what Dad was all about. Let me just be as brief as I can. That's a challenge for a Humphrey. On behalf of my brothers, Bob and Doug, who are here with us today, and the many members of the Humphrey family who are here, and I want to thank everyone who has worked so hard to have this day come true and to have this unveiling occur as I speak. Mr. President, and those who have spoken here today, thank you for your good words that remind us of the public work of our Father. He cared deeply about the people of Minnesota, our nation, and the world, as you have so eloquently articulated. He also cared deeply about our family. A man who seemed to be busy all the time, running all over the place, somehow or another, found time every day to reach out to every one of us. He was never far away, even though maybe he was physically far away. Both Mom and Dad made sure that even as they forged careers of outstanding public service, they also brought up the Humphrey brood with love and deep caring. For Dad and Mom, there was no separation between their public life and their family life. They gave us a normal, as normal a growing up as anyone in public office could ever have done, and we were all the better for the love that they shared with us. Now, finally, I just want to say one item here. Finally, Dad was a person who was passionately optimistic about this beautiful state of Minnesota and our country. He always was looking forward, reaching for greater opportunity of all. He loved the word avanti, forward. It was part of the motto of the city of Minneapolis and still is today. As he traveled throughout the world, he kept a small notebook of quotes, which I have somewhere in a box somewhere. And I'll just finish by this, of one of his favorite quotes, because it represents how much he believed in the promise of our nation. Here's what he often said, and you may have heard him as he gave his speeches. He quoted poet Carl Sandburg, and he said this: "I see America not in the setting sun of a black night of despair ahead of us. I see America in the crimson light of a rising sun, fresh from the burning creative hand of God. I see great days ahead, great days possible for men and women of will and vision." To me, that's what Hubert Humphrey, what my father, what our father, our dad, was all about. Thank you for being here with us.
And now finally, if I could ask Mr. President and Mr. Vice President, if I could ask you to join Skip and his brothers Bob and Doug in unveiling the memorial to their father.
Pull her down.